I'm going to ask really only one question today that I want you to take away. And I'm going to give you this question to begin with, and you can see it already on the screen that's been provided. It's also on the material that you've received in the foyer. And the issue is simply this: was Thomas correct? Before we get to that, let me give you a location. It's found at the end of the Gospel of John. It's chapter 20, verse 28, and it is the response of Thomas to the resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth. Thomas is an interesting person. He's only quoted about four times in the entire scriptures. He is an original pessimist. You will find, for instance, that in the story where Jesus went up to Bethany to raise Lazarus from the dead, that just before he returned to Bethany in the area of Jerusalem, they were attempting to stone Jesus because of his ministry, because he identified himself with God. And there was an open system in Jerusalem seeking to kill him. And when Jesus said, "I go to Bethany to raise our friend Lazarus," Thomas's response will be, "Well, let's go with him and die." He wrote the book, "Positive Thinking Will Advance You in All Things." The state of Missouri claims Thomas. He's the original show me man. He's the one who said, "If I don't see, if I don't touch, I will not believe that he's risen." And that's going to be the response. The response of Thomas, and we're going to come to it in just a little bit, is going to be this. Once he saw the risen Lord, there was this, "My Lord and my God." Now you've got the scripture. That's supposed to come at the end of the message. And you've got the punch. The question for me, the question for you is, was Thomas correct? Because if he was correct, then the Christian movement is the answer of the world. It's the reason we're in this room. We're worshiping on Sunday. Big news. It's kind of, hello. You know. We're worshiping on Sunday. Now, if we were Muslim, Islam worships on Friday. It's a significant moment in the revelations to their prophet Muhammad. So the holy day of Islam is Friday. If we were Hebrew Jews, we'd worship on Saturday. The old covenant, the Hebrew Sabbath, the Sabbath, is the conclusion of creation. God created the world in 7 days, and on the seventh day he rested. And so out of the law of Moses established the great day, the one in seven, and it would become the day of the Sabbath of God. And so Israel was there. But when the Christians began to move out of Israel, that early group of Jews who became followers of the way, they began to worship on the first day of the week, because this is what the early Christians believed. We believe that in Jesus Christ there has come all new creation, and we're part of the new world that is to come. And so we do not worship at the end of the old creation. We worship on the first day of the week of the new creation, and our day is the day of the resurrection. And the early Christians called this day the day of the Lord. Now, we're Americans. You know, that's why we have 28 different versions of the English Bible. Because we get the one, we just do what fits us and what's good for us, and we're just, that's us, you know. So in America, say, "Well, I'm going to worship on Saturday night because Sunday interferes with football, and I'm going to worship," you know. But you know what we're saying? And then we Americans respond something like this: "Well, it doesn't matter when you worship, as long as you worship." And I understand all that. I'm not fighting that. I'm just simply saying, from the beginning of Christianity, the reason we worship on Sunday morning is we are celebrators of the fact that our faith is built in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead. And in the writings of the great apostle, a former enemy of the church, Saul of Tarsus, in the writings of him who was once an assistant to the high priest, we have some of those powerful chapters. In the middle, there's one really powerful one. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I'm going to read just one paragraph here, beginning at verse 3 and going through verse 9. It goes like this: "First and foremost, I handed on to you that which I also received." The first and foremost means this is of primary importance. This is what is foundational to everything else. And he says, this is the foremost thing. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. That he was buried and that he raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He appeared to Caiaphas. Most Americans say Cephas. And afterwards to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers of our brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive. And though some of them have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, he appeared to me also, as one of untimely birth, for I am the least of the apostles. Indeed, I'm not even worthy or fit, this version says. I'm not worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. The greatest event in human history. According to the scriptures, we don't have proof that it was ever seen by a human being. When Jesus rose from the dead, the keepers, the guards, who had been placed there to watch the grave, were asleep. It may be that the resurrection took place in God without one human witness. The first ones to arrive at the grave were some women who came before sunrise wanting to care for the body. They are going to see an angel. One of the most famous lines of all. Why seek you the living among the dead? He is not here. He's risen as he said. Go tell his brothers. Go wake up those guys. Go tell them. Isn't it interesting that Jesus many times in his ministry said, I'll suffer and on the third day I'll rise. And his church, they hear that. Don't you think somebody was taking down a journal, sermon notes, Yep. And then, guess what? It's his enemies, the Sanhedrin, the high priest, who go to Pilate and say, this man, when he was alive, preached, he'd raise, go put a guard out there. Isn't that something? The enemies of the church believe more preaching than the church does. We just say amen and roll on, But the women are there. It's an amazing thing. And among the women, Mary Magdalene, the Bible tells us, John chapter 20, she ran back to the upper room and found Peter and John and says, and this was her statement. She said, they've taken the body of our Lord. We don't know where it is. And so Peter takes off running and John takes off running. John's much younger, so he outruns the old man. It's a tradition we still carry on. But John gets to the grave and waits there. And then when Peter gets there, he goes in and they both see it. Now, I love Mary because her witness is right. The grave is empty. The body's gone. Her conclusions are flat wrong. They've taken the body. She got her facts right and her conclusions wrong. And when the two men saw it, it says they believed. It's careful not to tell us what they believed. But it does say in scriptures, they believed. Now, Mary will follow the boys back to the grave, and she'll linger. And she'll be there crying when a voice behind her says, "What woman, why are you crying?" And she's thinking, it's the garden, remember? If you've taken his body, tell me that I may care for it. Where is it? And then she hears the name. She hears the tones she's learned to love. And the voice comes echoing, marriage. And then you have the famous Rabboni. And she holds on to him and he says, you can't hold me here. I have not yet ascended, but you go tell my brothers. That afternoon, we're told, two men are walking home to Emmaus and they're heavy. They're depressed in their feelings. Their stranger walks up next to them. See, the liturgical churches, the churches out of which we revolted, the Greek Orthodox, the Roman Catholic, the Episcopalians, the Anglicans, the Lutherans, you know what they'd say to us evangelicals? You think Easter is a day once a year. It isn't. It's a season. So beginning at Easter all the way to Pentecost, they have on their liturgical calendar the season of Easter. Because you see, Jesus didn't simply raise from the dead. He appeared for 40 days. And during those 40 days, the Bible Bible tells us, beginning with Moses and the prophets, he explained the kingdom. The way we Christians read the Old Testament began with the resurrected Lord. Well, that didn't seem to impress you. Let me try this. The way we teach the Old Testament began with a dead man. Jesus risen from the Lord changed the way we read the scriptures of Israel. There is a Christian way to read the Bible. And it began in him. And here he is walking with them on the road to Emmaus. And we know how impacting the death of Jesus was in Jerusalem, because these two men are talking. And he says, what's impressing you? He says, are you a stranger in Israel that you don't know these things? It's at the end of Luke's gospel. Apparently, they're shocked that anybody could have been in Jerusalem and not known what was depressing. That tells you that the death of Jesus had a citywide impact. That night when he breaks the bread, they suddenly know it's the Lord. And even though it'll break the Sabbath, they take off running to get back to Jerusalem. And when they get to the upper room, guess what's happened? Sometime that afternoon, according to the Bible, remember? We just read it from Corinthians. And he appeared to Peter. Now, that must have been a meeting. Peter had had a rough weekend. Can you imagine what that conversation was like? You know, I love the one-liners in here. You know, Paul just puts this line in. And he appeared to James. If you were to pick up my Bible and look at it, you know what it says after he appeared to James? I have, tell me more. One-liner. You know what the scripture says? When Jesus was alive and preaching, his brothers didn't believe in him. Mary's alone at the cross. That's why Jesus has to give Mary to John for care, remember? So the oldest next brother that doesn't believe in him, it says, and Jesus appeared to James. Now, James is going to become the shepherd of Jerusalem, the head of the church, and he's going to write one of the books in your Bible. And another brother, Jude, is going to write the book of Jude in your Bible. Two of Jesus' brothers actually are going to write part of the New Testament. But while he was alive, they didn't believe. What do you think that meeting was like? You know, if Jesus had been Irish instead of Hebrew, it would have been What did the resurrected Jesus say to a brother? What a moment. I'd like to know the conversation. And he appeared to James. I guess that would have been a moment. Well, then it says that while it was evening and those two got back to the upper room, suddenly Jesus is in the midst. There's only 10 of the disciples there. See, Judas has already shipped out to where Judas went. And Thomas, he's typical. We're without a pastor and I'm out of here. You know, Thomas, when God did his biggest work, Thomas wasn't in the crowd. Times were tough and they were down and he was shut out. And all of a sudden, here's Jesus. When they tell Thomas about it, they go get him. You know, they have visitation teams that go out and evangelize. And say, Thomas, Jesus appeared. And I suppose Thomas had one of those, why does that always happen when I'm not there? No, he had that. Unless I touch, unless I thrust my hand in the wound, I won't believe. Now, there are interesting moments, but on the second Sunday, the week after, so Jesus just lets Thomas go for a week. Then on the week after, suddenly there's a voice in the room. Can you imagine? Thomas is with the others, and they're all talking about what he can't take in. And then all of a sudden, a voice says, Thomas, come here. Now there's a moment. You know, in the famous oil painting by a man named Raphael, there's a picture of Thomas taking his finger and putting it in the wound. You know, there's nothing in Scripture that says he touched him. We assume it did, because Jesus said, come, thrust your hand, come touch. You know what happened? Immediately, my Lord and my God. In my mind, Thomas fell to his knees, my Lord and my God. I'm sure he did. John forgot to write it. I don't know. Then there's the time up at the lake These boys are always going fishing. John chapter 21, 7 of them are in a boat, fish all night and catch nothing. That's a biblical tradition for those guys. And then someone on the shore, lads, do you have any fish? No, we fished all night, caught nothing. At least you're consistent. I love it. Throw your net on the right side. Do you know how many times in Scripture Jesus says, throw your net? Why don't they start there? And then when John says to Peter, it's the Lord. And then Jesus is fixing fish on the shore. Cooks breakfast for him. What a moment. There's 500 on a hillside. Go into all the world. John, Matthew chapter 20. Make disciples, baptizing them in the name. You know, it's tremendous, the Great Commission. And then there's the other stories. You know, he's walking in Jerusalem up the Mount of Olives. He's teaching them. They're saying, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom? Acts chapter 1. Going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He says, it's not for you to know the time. Oh, come on. We want to write some books. Prophecy will sell. No, it's not for you to know the times or season the Lord's reserved for himself. But as they're walking up the hill, he said, you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes. And all of a sudden, they get to the top of the hill, and he keeps walking. And when they realize they're getting a crook in their head, two angels appear. You men of Galilee, why stand you here looking up? Well, we're waiting for the eclipse. What are they doing? They are caught up in the moment of the resurrection and the ascension of the Son of God. This same Jesus will come just as you've seen him go away. What a moment! He wasn't done yet. My Bible says after the ascension, when they're killing the first Christian martyr, and a phenomenal guy, Acts chapter 6, Acts chapter 7, and at the end of Stephen's great sermon, they're stoning him, and suddenly he says, I see Jesus standing. Jesus appeared again to the first Christian death. On the road in Damascus, the enemy of the church, the assistant of the high priest, Saul of Tarsus, is riding to arrest Christians in Damascus when suddenly the light strikes him to the ground. Saul, Saul, why do you persecute? Jesus continues appearing after his ascension. On a little island called Patmos, where a man named John has been banished by Caesar, he says, I hear behind me a voice, and when I turn to see the voice, Jesus appears to John on the Isle of Patmos. It just keeps going on. Resurrection. But what I'm talking about today happened just one week in. When Thomas said, unless I touch, unless I thrust, I will not believe. Never give too strong a testimony. And suddenly, come here, Thomas. But that's not the question I started with. The question was, is Thomas right? When he said, my Lord and my God. First of all, remember who Thomas is. Thomas is not Scandinavian. Thomas is a Jew. Jewish boys couldn't even carry coins with an image on it because there's only one God. Jewish boys, by the time that Thomas was born in the hour of Jesus, Hebrews could not say the name Yahweh. In the scriptures, everywhere that God's name appears, Yahweh, they change it to Lord, Adonai. Why? Because they want to make sure they don't blaspheme the holy name. And as a result, God's name is so holy, you can't say it. So in the hour of our master, the name Yahweh, which still appears in Hebrew text, but every time your Bible is translated, all those little capital letters Lord in your Old Testament, it really isn't Lord. They're not translating it. They're honoring the Hebrews. And what they're doing is every time that name Lord is in your Old Testament, the name actually in the Hebrew is Yahweh. Hear, O Israel, Yahweh is your Lord and God. You shall have them. But we say, hear, O Israel, Lord is your God. cannot say the holy name. So when he said, my Lord, he wasn't talking English. I know that's a shock to you. We all know he was reading King James. But the English language won't be around for another 1,400 years, folks. You know what he's saying? The first thing he said is, my Adonai. Now, when Americans say Lord, they mean Jesus is boss. You know, understand, Jesus is my Lord. It means he can call the shots. He's in control. He's my master. That's not what a Jew means. A Jew means the holy name. You know the oldest creed of the church? It's not the Apostles' Creed. You know, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, maker of heaven and earth, Jesus Christ, our only Son, our... No, no, no. That's 200 years later. The oldest creed is quoted by Paul, and it is this: Jesus is Lord. But you know what they meant when they wrote that? Jesus is the God of Israel. Jesus is the Adonai. Jesus is Yahweh. But in case he hadn't crossed all the T's and dotted all the I's, listen to what Thomas says. My Lord and my God. Either he's a blasphemer in that moment or he's correct. See, he doesn't just say, Jesus is my Adonai. He says, Jesus is my Elohim. My Adonai and my Elohim. Elohim being the name that the ancient Canaanites had given the Hebrew, the name of the one true God, the Most High. He literally said it. The question for you and the question for me is Jesus more than a holy person, more than a nice guy who came around? I have a friend in Israel. We've been there lots of times together. His name is Stephen Langford, Dr. Stephen Langford, I should say. He has his graduate, his PhD is Brandeis University. He's a Jew. He's an expert in New Testament. He would shame 90% of the Christians with the knowledge he has of Jesus. Christians fly from all over the world, Japan, Germany, America, everywhere, to go study under Steve Langford about Jesus. Steve and I have been friends. We've had many Cokes together. He even attended a Protestant seminary, exposed everything. We've spent hours visiting when no one else was around. And he'll say to me, I can believe everything about Jesus but the resurrection. And I'll say to him, Steve, that's why you're not a Christian. And he says, that's right. And we've been in circles where we take communion. Steve won't take it. You wonder why? He knows all about Jesus, but he doesn't know Jesus. He could shame us in this room, make us feel stupid. But the truth of the matter is, Thomas wasn't correct. But I say to you, Thomas was correct. And if Thomas was correct, this church isn't going through a hollow moment right now. You're just simply on the edge of tomorrow, and if you'll hold fast, God's going to really do something in your midst. If Thomas is correct, I don't know what you're facing personally, but you'll be all right. If Thomas was correct, he'll bring you through. Let me just say this, and we're going to sing. I eventually, for over 15 years, at a school nearby you might have heard of, Tribeca Nazarene University, not going to say its name, I was professor of homiletics. I taught advanced preaching. It's kind of a miracle, you know. Why? Because I've never had a class in preaching. Never studied at one time. All my degrees are in Bible, Greek, Hebrew, and exegesis. never had preaching. In fact, because I've just told you my emphasis is on language, let me just listen to this. Listen to this. In eighth grade English grammar, Roosevelt Middle School now, but junior high school then, Roosevelt, the teacher gave me a D to get rid of me so she wouldn't have to put up with me another year. Because I could not get language. But God, having a sense of humor, called me to preach. And in my freshman year, in the middle of the Vietnam War, where if you flunked, we were all in numb. I had 8 hours of something called rhetoric, which is intense English. And to graduate, you had to give a three-minute speech without notes, and I flunked flat. Because I couldn't speak publicly. I called Radine. She was in a women's Bible study 28 miles away, and I said, they're going to put me out of college or give me one more chance this afternoon. She said, we'll go to prayer, you go to prayer. I went to the chapel of Iowa University in the middle of the hour when we were burning all our graph cards and bras and whatever. Back there in that hour, in that moment, I knelt in the chapel all alone, because you want to get alone in Iowa, you went to the chapel. God, the Holy Spirit came over me. Mm-hmm. The next Sunday, I preached for 45 minutes without notes. People came down every aisle to the altar. And I've been doing it for 55 years. And I forgot to take the course. Now listen, I know this is a dumb statement, but listen to this. Then I became professor of the subject. Here's the question, was Thomas correct? I suggest here, Jesus is not just the holiest person that ever